The following program is brought to you by Rogers Anyplace TV. Enjoy exclusive content for free. Visit RogersAnyplaceTV.com.
Welcome to the local campaign. Our debate today is for the candidates who are running for your vote on October the 27th in College Ward, Ward 8. We're going to introduce those candidates to you now, and then we'll get into the debate on Rogers TV. So first up, we have Scott McLarens, Rick Shirelli, Craig McCauley, and Guy Annable. Welcome to all of you. Thank you for joining us for the debate. Here's how it's going to work. We're going to give each candidate 1 minute to provide an opening statement, and the order for those opening statements was drawn at random just before our telecast. Then we'll get into a series of discussions and debates about some of the big topics that are of importance in College Ward and throughout the city. For each of those debates, we'll start with a question directed at one candidate in particular. That candidate will have a minute to answer the question. Then we'll open it up to all the candidates for an open discussion on that subject. And then when that's over, we'll go back to the candidate to whom the question was directed, and he will have 30 seconds to wrap up on that topic. We'll move through a number of different topics that way, and then we'll get to closing statements. Once again, each candidate will have 60 seconds for a closing statement, and we'll do those in the opposite order of the opening statements. So let's begin. And the first opening statement is from Scott McLarens. You have 60 seconds. Go ahead.
For a number of years now, our city council has been almost a legacy, saying the same, not bringing anything new to the table. As a recent graduate, I come forward for College Ward to offer you hard work and perseverance, an ethic, which I think we could really use after some of the fiascos of recent times. I believe that I can offer something new for our students, our professionals, and our retirees, and I'd like the opportunity to take my hard work into council to represent the thoughts and the diverse needs of our community.
Okay, thank you. Up next is Rick Shirelli. You have a minute as well. Go ahead.
Thank you. We need experience now more than ever. An unprecedented number of veteran city councillors are not seeking re-election this time. The city needs experience, people who know what is actually possible and how to make that happen. Experience, results. As one of the original backers of the Lansdowne Renewal Project and the mover of the 2009 motion that began the process to put the city into that commitment, I have proven that experience means results citywide. I've also proven that experience means results in our communities, where I continue to use my experience to protect the character of our communities from illegal home conversions and illegal rooming houses. I've dedicated my career to making College Ward a better place and the city of Ottawa a better place. I ask for your support.
All right, thank you very much. And next up, we have Craig McCauley. Go ahead, you have 1 minute.
Hi. Zero means zero means zero. My first promise, I will accept zero money from the taxpayer once elected. Zero salary, zero fat pension, zero corruption. Zero means zero. Second zero, I will spend zero money on my campaign for election. You shouldn't be able to spend your way to power with dirty money. Third zero, once elected, I will exercise zero personal power. Three strong opinions, councillors should not take cash from corporations and unions. Two, I support ranked choice voting. Three, community associations should be transparent, accountable, and democratic. What do you think? Go to bellscorners.wordpress.com, bellscorners.wordpress.com. Certain conditions apply. You must be of legal age to vote.
All right, thank you. And finally, the opening statement from Guy Annable. Go ahead.
Good morning. I'd like to thank Rogers, Mark Sutcliffe, and Lynne Whitehead for putting this debate on. It's part of the engagement and debate that we need in the city. I sat on the Business Advisory Committee for 3 years at City Hall. I had a very good experience on how city staff and councillors work, and basically the processes that go on and spend almost $3 billion of your tax dollars. I promise not to accept campaign contributions from companies that do business with the City of Ottawa. It is just wrong. I'm only one vote on council, but it is time for a wholesale change on City Hall. As Mr. Shirelli just said, six councillors with less tenure than him have decided not to run. It's not a lifelong job, but nobody's told Rick that. On October 27th, give Guy a college try. I will protect your tax dollars, I will read contracts, and I will not accept contributions from city companies that benefit from those contracts.
All right. Thank you to all of you for your opening statements. Let's get into the debate now. I'm going to start with a question to Scott McLaren's. And let's talk about taxes. What is the right level for tax increases going forward in the city? You've got a minute to answer this, and then we'll open it up to all the candidates on this question. Go ahead.
Truth be told, I don't have much experience on looking exactly at taxes. I think I'd like to look at, I couldn't give you any numbers, I'd like to look at a minimal increase at best. What that is, I cannot say. That's not a question I was plenty prepared for.
Okay, well, we can open it up to everyone on this. We've got a few minutes for debate. It's open to everyone. Go ahead.
Can I go?
Yeah, go whenever you want. Yeah.
Okay, well, on taxes, I think 2% is a reasonable goal. But I don't think it should be a hard cap because we don't know what the future holds. There'll probably be cost overruns with the Lansdowne and LRT fiascos. So I don't think 2% should be a hard cap because there are certain services that are too important to cut.
If I may, with regards to taxes, I think you have to look at the overall revenue stream and expense stream of the City of Ottawa. Over 54% of our almost $3 billion operating budget goes to salaries. We have 18,000 hardworking individuals at the City of Ottawa. However, we have the highest per capita ratio of a city employees to citizens in the country. That has to change. Where it's going to change, if you vote for me, I will basically look at the efficiencies that can be sought in reducing city staff, increasing the efficiencies, and looking at exactly how those development charges that are rolling into the City of Ottawa are spent.
Okay, well, I started my political career working with Ben Franklin. And with Ben Franklin, we had the pay-as-you-go system in the city of Nepean. And over time, our city became debt-free. And how did we do it? Well, the first thing we did is we pegged taxes so that they couldn't go above the rate of inflation. And that system, over the long haul, ended up with the city of Nepean having the lowest tax rate across the entire province. The City of Ottawa, as it stands now, is the single largest rural municipality in the province. That's right, the largest rural municipality. In our geography, you can fit the city of Montreal, Toronto, Calgary, Edmonton, and Vancouver. All of them in that geography. So we have a challenge to try to develop our city services and serve all residents equally and well, while at the same time holding taxes to a reasonable level. And I think that's what we do when we peg taxes to at or about the rate of inflation. And I think every city that varies from that ends up in trouble. And if you look other places in Ontario, Mississauga, Hazel McCallion, who is not running again, but is over 90 years old and extremely popular in her city, has followed the same sort of fiscal discipline and responsibility and long-term planning. It's when you get into the short one-year decisions to make a cut here or there or make an addition here or there that I think you end up in some trouble.
Mr. Shirelli counts on people having short memories, and that quote that had the city of taxpayers of Nepean having the lowest tax rate in the province is just untrue.
Can I talk about taxes in terms of efficiencies? One example of efficiency would be the $250,000 a year office budget that Councillor Chiarelli abuses so deviously. So I'm not going to take that budget, and I'm not going to take the salary. That would be a savings of $500,000 a year for the taxpayer. Multiply that by 23 councillors. So I would call on my other candidates to endorse that position.
I still don't know what the external services that he bills every year for $50,000 are. We're still waiting for that information.
That's a good point. I wish we could have more debates. This is the only debate.
With 18,000 people, why do you need to bill out $50,000 a year in external services, Rick? Could you explain that?
Well, I've already discussed the tax rate, which
external
is the question.
External services.
The tax rate question I'll be happy to follow up on. Over 21 straight years, the city of Nepean kept its taxes below the rate of inflation. There is no other city in Canada that did that. City of Mississauga followed the inflation tax target and has for the last at least 15 years and has done very well with that. And, you know, I think if you go to any resident of the former Nepean and asked, were you well run then? Would you like us to run ourselves like we did in the former city of Nepean? The answer would be yes, a resounding yes.
Well, we can't raise Ben Franklin from the grave, Rick, that's for sure.
That's not what I hear on the street. I think people are fed up and they want to change. I don't know. We must not be talking to the same people again.
Obviously not.
I hope not.
Okay, well, let's leave it there. And Scott and Clarence, you do have 30 seconds if you want to wrap up on this topic. If you've got something to say, go ahead.
I think one of the big problems we have here is that everyone is committed to a promise. As Craig said, we have put ourselves into some very big projects right here, and we have no idea what the future will hold as they develop. We know, for example, the problems which Boston found when they tried to build themselves a very big tunnel, and as an example, that could see us well off the mark, and it's the promises that could be the problem.
If there wasn't...
Okay, we'll stop there. Thank you. Let's move on to the next question, and I'll direct this one to Rick Shirelli. I think a lot of city taxpayers are concerned about a number of issues that have happened in the last term or that have come to light in the last term. Things like the green bin contract, which the Auditor General released a report on, identifying a number of major concerns. The airport pedestrian bridge, the Strand Heard Armstrong Bridge as well, the delays in that. So is accountability an issue for current members of council who are running for re-election? You and others have said there were issues with staff, but doesn't the buck stop with city councillors?
Oh, absolutely. And that's and accountability rests with councillors, with existing councillors, future councillors, and past councillors, and with others as well. I'm very proud of the Orga World Audit. Even before I was named chair of the audit committee, we saw a need to do auditing a bit differently than it used to be done. And after I was named chair, I sat down with our vice chair, Councillor Hubley, and the rest of the committee, and we set out as a goal, as our mission, to have the Auditor General do audits in areas that involve big money, not the flashy, sensational areas that used to be done. And we decided we would do that no matter how bad it looked at City Hall, because it's the right thing to do and because it's exercising our responsibility and our accountability. We did that, and I'm proud that as a result of the Orga World Audit, we now have the opportunity to save significant dollars in the future.
Okay, it's open to everyone now.
Yep.
The moderator of this debate on July 31st wrote one of the best articles I have ever read on the cycle of mistakes at City Hall. I asked the viewers of this program to look at the Ottawa Citizen and read Mark Sutcliffe's article on July the 31st. It nails on the head exactly what the problems are with the City of Ottawa procurement practices and basically the line of supply chain management that ends up with these boondoggles on council's table to rubber stamp. I'm not blaming Rick totally for the green bin contract, but he could have read it. And to say that he was misled by city staff is just disingenuous. Mark made some excellent points with regards to placing a city financial officer in the process as these 10-year projects happen. Green Bin went through three mayors, two trials, one the incumbent participated in, but they couldn't pick up a calculator and basically look at why the 80,000 ton put or pay was just a ludicrous, ludicrous amount. And that cost you your weekly garbage, folks. So every time you see maggots in the garage or you're wondering when those garbage bags are paying, you can thank councillors that are supposed to be on the board of directors for you, the city shareholder. And if you don't read a contract, you're not doing your job. But I do encourage you to read that article. It just points out exactly the problems within the supply chain management. We need to place oversight in the process and not let city staff run amok and get these piles of reports that are presented to staff the night before a council meeting to vote on. And these are just some of the problems with city staff. They've been there far too long and become far too comfortable with your tax dollars. You must read to basically be educated, because if you listen to Rick, you're not getting the full story.
Well, the reason we have the information that people talk about around the Orga World audit is because Councillor McCrae and the audit committee took a look, heard some second-hand, third-hand information from different people, and became a bit suspicious. And with Councillor McCrae's motion, followed by some diligence by the audit committee, we went back to investigate a set of decisions that happened 7 years ago.
You had 10 years,
and,
Rick.
And
you
in
were
that
on
time,
the trial.
We
could you not have picked up a calculator?
Audit,
could you not have read the
audit
contract?
Determined exactly
that
what
that's why
the
I'm
were.
With, I'm with
and
this
we continue
guy
to,
on accountability. Like to have literally lecture us about accountability seems ludicrous to me. Accountability would not be wasting $500,000 a year.
Contract.
The question is about accountability, and accountability
yes.
is exercised by council members when they do things like set up an audit to look at a set of events that happened
wash,
7 years
it's not
ago.
Gonna wash with the
that was 10 years
audit.
After the process.
We did that audit. We didn't have to. More cynical politicians may have just said, hey, leave that alone.
You
nobody's going to look.
You were there
we
the
did
whole
the audit,
time.
And as a result of
you
doing
the
audit, we have
the
this
whole
information.
Time.
And with this information, we're able
wow.
to make changes
auditors
and savings to taxpayers over $50 million.
All right, go ahead if anybody wants to jump in here.
Well, I've had my say.
I think the real problem here is the question of accountability and who signs this contract to begin with, and why this is
source.
Why this is put through the
sole source.
Like Lansdowne.
Dale Harley
Lansdowne.
Put 20 years
Dale
on the
Harley.
Table. Halton got 5 years. They got a ramp up period to get to the targets. We are the only city that signed a 20-year source organics contract, and it is a crime. The fact that supply chain management recommended a ramp up period and that the solid waste manager didn't even regard it is just a crime. We will see the 80,000 tons reached in year 19. $140 million contract, $67 million of that contract will be wasted because councillors can't read a contract. $67 million that could have gone into social housing, that could have gone into so many projects. And Rick talks about accountability.
On the issue of accountability, Rick is talking garbage.
He's talking garbage. This year, we are reaching the Orga World targets.
Oh, with leaf and yard waste? Yeah, sure. It wasn't even supposed to be there. Only 35%, right? Come on. Come on. Spin it somewhere else.
The request for proposals. From day one, the city always demanded that 20 to 30% of the contents going to Orga World would be leaf and yard waste. Why? Because nothing composts unless you have leaf and yard waste in it.
Maybe
so the,
30%
the result of that is that you do have leaf and yard waste going to Orga World. But aside from that, look, if we didn't do that audit, we would not have this information. We would not be able to achieve the savings.
If you
accountability
were contracts,
means that
might
even
have been
though
better.
It's accountability means that even though
there's
it's
no
not going to make you popular,
no
you go and you do the right thing anyway. You do the audit.
I'm not saying the heads should roll.
You get a renegotiated record. You know, Jim won't even meet with Orgerworld. Okay. They were ready to fly people over here.
We're out of time, but actually, Rick Shirelli, I did ask the question to you, so you've got 30 seconds to wrap up on this topic.
Well, you know, Mark, the Orgerworld contract obviously was fraught with mistakes, but remember one thing. It was a competitive process. There were bids. Orgerworld was the lowest bid and was picked. And as a result of that, we moved into the Green Bin program. Since then, exercising our accountability, the audit committee, with help from Councillor McRae, moved forward and did the audit, even though we knew what it would find would be embarrassing for City Hall. Now we have the opportunity to solve the problem.
Thank you very much. Let's stop there and move on to the next question, which I'll direct to Craig McCauley. And let's talk about cycling. There are people recommending that we invest more money every year in cycling infrastructure, quite a significant amount of money. Do you support that? Is that something that you think would benefit the taxpayers of Ottawa?
How much time do I have?
You have a minute.
Okay, I'll just say yes, I support it. I mean, really, I know it's not popular. I know there are a lot of people out there that hate cyclists, and they think that cyclists should pay their fair share. And I agree with that. We already do pay our fair share. So much of our tax dollars goes into road expansion, like in Bell's Corners. Very little actually gets invested in cycling compared to what our needs are. So may not be popular, but yes, I definitely think that we need to invest in our cycling infrastructure before someone else gets killed. We can't go on forever denying climate change and building more roads. They're hugely expensive. Cyclists pay their fair share through their property taxes, just like motorists.
Okay, it's open to everyone now. We've got a few minutes to debate this topic. Go ahead.
Well, I'm happy that in the new transportation master plan, we were able to get into the plan separated cycling lanes for Bell's Corners.
What? That's not a cycling lane. That's a death trap. Cycling is
Bell's
more
Corners,
dangerous
there
now.
There is no,
no, that's not true.
Cycling lane facility.
You can't call it a cycling
and
lane.
And as a result,
Rick,
what we're doing is...
The truth matters,
when,
I think.
When we conduct
cycling lane,
our reconstruction right. to comply with the transportation right. master plan, in that we will have dedicated cycling lanes. And
in the year 2087 in Bell's Corners case.
And we will be enabling people to, you know, move from that link from the neighborhoods and the bike paths in behind Bell's Corners onto a stretch that will ultimately link them to downtown. So it'll be possible for people who live, work, and play in Bell's Corners to cycle much further. It's also going to be possible for tourists who are going to be the niche of Bell's Corners in the coming years to grab a bike and go use it. And I think that's significant. You know, with the Department of National Defense moving to Moody Drive.
Well, that's right. That was
with
because
nearly
you brought them here. I think that was your decision that brought
then what's
the
going to happen
to Nortel.
Is you're going to have those
thanks
employees,
to you.
And you're also going to have hotels housing many people, hundreds of people a day visiting Department of National Defense, and they'll all have, for the first time, access to bike lanes that will interconnect them to a network that will ultimately take them downtown. And I think that's a great step forward. Whether
so
I would
the generals
be committed
are
to
be riding up to General
to
Dynamics
the,
on
to
a bicycle,
a specific dollar amount
what?
Over the next 4 years for cycling, I'm not sure. I would like to take it on a need by need basis and see where it makes sense. And in Bell's Corners, it makes sense.
Go ahead, Scott.
Oh, I'd like to understand where that need is just about a half block from each intersection and not a continued safe cycling lane from one end of town to the other. Why things are being done in half measures and started and stopped and then started further along and then stopped and then started again when...
Well, the city tends to, well, in the last several years anyway, tends to construct cycling lanes in conjunction with other transportation projects so that we can get them done at very little cost. So if we time them with our projects in the transportation master plan, we can piece by piece grow a network. Very few cities, with the exception of Montreal, try to put together entire cycling networks in one fell swoop. Usually These things are done incrementally, step by step. Now they're being done strategically. And I think it's going to be great for cyclists, and it's going to be great for safety.
He's just making them any safer.
I know this is all of college words, so it's ridiculous to be talking about Bell's Corners. Like, there's three candidates out of four from Bell's Corners. So believe me, all you people in other parts of the ward. But what's happening here is similar to other places. So Rick's cycling lane gets people through the intersection, just like in many other parts of College Ward, with cars on both sides of them zipping away, and then all of a sudden the cycling lane ends and they're thrown into traffic. Like, it's just a disaster waiting to happen. So I hope we don't wait until someone gets killed in the Bell's Corner Strip before with something, or any other part of College Ward. It's green, it's environmentally friendly.
Cycling lanes in the transportation master plan, they would not be built.
And you can take them in the plan. You're the least cycling friendly council there is. When's the last time you rode a bike, Rick? When's the last time you rode a bike? Except for a photo op.
And with this plan,
have you ever ridden a bike in your life?
A continuous cycling lane that goes through the Bell's Corner Strip and connects people who want to find a way
downtown. Did you ride a bike to Lansdowne Park to watch the Red Blacks game, or did you drive your car?
I have to interject here, and I have to agree with Councillor Shirelli in looking at the Transportation Master Plan. Right now, we're spending 0.8% of our transportation budget, which, again, there's a lot of money going into that budget, but you have to do things in stages. You can't just roll out a bike lane from one end of Bell's Corners to another. And with all due respect, Craig, with all due respect, the great thing is we're having the conversation. The accident in Manotick 2 weeks ago was a tragedy. We have to separate bikes from cars. We need plastic bollards at the intersections to take...
It's part of the solution.
I agree, but you can't do everything at once. So you know what? I have to applaud Councillor Shirelli as a person who is going with the Transportation Master Plan in lockstep with Jim, because we need to be more like Copenhagen. We need to get cars off the road. And, you know...
Okay, can I just say about the 0.08% is spent on cycling infrastructure?
And
is
I
that
don't
what
think
you
we
say?
Should go to 2%
what
like cycling.
What percentage
Citizens
of the trips are
cycling?
Made by... cyclists in Ottawa. It's 1.5% or 2%.
If they felt safer, they would take bikes more often.
If 2% of the trips are by bike...
You're the biggest advocate of bikes.
Can
so
I finish my thought,
towards,
please?
Yeah.
Before
you're
going
to have 30 seconds to wrap up on this anyway.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
But
go ahead right now.
Okay.
Yeah.
If 0.8% of the transportation budget or whatever is spent on cycling, yet 1.4% or 2.5%, or way more than that, of the trips are made by cyclists, shouldn't they get their fair share? Why do we have to spend disproportionately more on roads? More and bigger roads are not the solution. And to have Rich Shirelli advocate for cycling is pretty funny to me.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on to the next question. I'll direct this one to Guy Annable. And you and a couple of the other candidates have talked about campaign donations in your opening statements. So is it inappropriate for a candidate to accept donations from companies that do business with the city? And if so, do we need to change the rules about this rather than rely on candidates to reject those donations themselves?
Thank you for that question, Mark. And let's go through a little bit of history with regards to Toronto. In 2009, City of Toronto Council voted 29-12 to ban all municipal contributions from any campaign, and that took place under David Miller's rule.
Yep.
Now, when you are scrutinizing a $15 hockey ticket under the Ethics Commissioner and the Lobbying Commissioner when council is sitting, but yet when the writ drops, you can have what we call unnamed fundraisers, which are a way of laundering campaign donations, and unticketed events where people can drive up with bags of cash, walk in, buy a table, and basically walk out. It is wrong. It sends the wrong message. It sends the wrong optics. And for Jim Watson and Councillor Shirelli to say, oh, if you think you can buy me for $750... Well, you know, that statement in itself is just wrong.
It's open to everyone now.
$1,000.
Well, let's poise it to Rick. Rick, Why won't we, would you produce a motion at council which will ban your developer friends with, if you look, your donation list is basically every developer in Ottawa and garbage company and green waste company. I find it interesting you didn't read the contract, but yet you took $2,250 from Orgerwald and Tomlinson in the 2006 election. So talk to me about that, Rick.
There was more than that.
Okay,
talk to me.
I'd like to thank all the individuals and local businesses who believe in what I'm doing and have supported my campaign, and those who are going to do so over the coming days. I believe in a democracy. That's just one way that everybody can participate. The provincial government sets the rules as to who can donate and how much.
You
the provincial government,
by law.
The city of Ottawa has
no
jurisdiction
to
override
the
rules.
Just say no.
The city of Toronto is the only city in Ontario that has the legal authority to deal with campaign contributions. Mm-hmm. So the province sets the rules. And what do they consider when they set the rules? They do a balance. They balance
the need to raise money
to run a campaign, along with the need to ensure that you don't have to be rich to run. And they balance that against any possible undue influence. And then they arrive at a number that they say will be fairly certain of preventing any undue influence as a result of the contribution. And I'm glad that they set the number so low that nobody really believes that you can buy
a
vote from a member of council.
Would you support a motion to cancel unnamed and unticketed fundraisers? Would you support a motion? Would you support a motion, Rick?
Just as much.
Pull the string, you get the same answer.
Okay, Councilor.
The province set the rules. The province set the rules. They have the legal authority to set the rules.
You have a bylaw interpretation which you can take.
Okay. Councillor Charlie mentioned that he wanted to thank all the individuals and businesses that finance his re-election campaign. And in 2010, it's available online, you can see it, and there were very few individuals. Like, there were this many individuals. 95% of your funding came from corporations? Almost no individuals support you. Who's going to give you money? Even with the rebate program where they get the money back. So
Rick bought $14 in campaign buttons. He supported his own campaign.
Well, that was
so. I guess he had enough money from developers.
That was a mistake. He had to resubmit his form because there were mistakes.
Good on you, Craig. Good on you for that.
Well, yes. And all I can say is, Rick does not have to take the corporate money. He should not take the corporate money. And I ask you, Councillor Charlie, please, are you willing? I know you're taking it. And we will know eventually, because it's public information, but only after the election. Are you prepared to reveal your corporate funding? Who's financing your campaign? Are you prepared to reveal the names, at least, of the corporations and individuals?
I think it's important.
Will you reveal it before the election?
I think it's important that everybody understands the province makes the rules. How much did Don Robertson make the rules? Don Robertson.
If
people don't like the rules the province sets, they should be taking that
you
up
have
with their
They don't have to change. They should vote for a councillor that will not accept campaign donations. They should vote for a councillor that thinks it's optically wrong. Not who doesn't want to stop the gravy train.
That would be me. Not me. But
it's wrong. It's optically
Everyone knows it's wrong. Everyone knows it's wrong.
And it makes you look bad, Rick. It really does.
And you don't need the money.
You don't need
all
the
advantages
money.
Of incumbency. You could kick-clock to power with all the way you abuse your $250,000. And look at the all the campaign literature that got sent out just before the blackout date. Apparently, that's not counted as campaign literature. But just look at it. It is campaign literature.
Let's look at an actual situation that happened this week. On Tuesday, Mayor Watson had a fundraiser at Sen's house. Mayor Watson gave $75,000 of your money to three community associations to fight the Taggart Miller dump. Yet, on Tuesday, who do you think held the fundraiser for Jim Watson at Sen's house?
Taggart
Miller. So, Jim, come on.
Wait a minute.
Change the rule. No, this is exactly what's wrong with unnamed fundraisers and unticketed fundraisers. You don't have to put your name towards a fundraiser. You just drive up, walk in with bags of cash, buy a table, shake a hand, eat some curry chicken favor, and get the curry chicken from Jim after the election. It's wrong and it should be stopped. Let's take the lead that Toronto took. Stop the gravy train. I hate to use Rob Ford's motto, but you know what, folks? You are getting your money wasted. And on one hand, they're sucking and blowing in the same breath.
I couldn't have said it better. Vote for Guy.
Okay. Guy Annable, you've got 30 seconds to wrap up on this if you want to say anything more on this topic.
There's a lot of things at City Hall that are broken, folks. I can't even start to begin. Campaign financing is one of them. But the sheer fact that year after year and election after election, people say, oh, you can't buy me for $750. And people that go into these fundraisers with bags of cash and walk out with contracts a couple of years later. Peter Hume collected $22,500 in the 2006 election. From who? Probably the company that supported the Orgerworld contract.
Well, we'll
but we'll never know because it's an unnamed fundraiser.
Okay.
Change the rules.
There. Thank you. And I'll remind everybody when I'm directing a question to a candidate and they have that 1 minute or they have the 30 seconds at the end, that belongs to them exclusively. So no one else should be speaking during that time. Thank you. Let's move on to another question for Scott McLaren's. And I want to come back to this issue of garbage. We touched on it in the context of accountability. But do you support continuing with biweekly garbage collection or do you think we should go back to weekly collection? You have a minute.
I think when we look at the issue of bi-weekly and weekly garbage pickup, we could do this as a sort of a combined effort. We could be weekly in the summer when we are having the maggots and the rot and the stink, and go back when we have, you know, Ottawa winters, and go to week or bi-weekly in winter, saving ourselves money, but getting rid of that nuisance that we currently have sitting in our garages. But I think overall, we're looking at this entirely the wrong way. We need to look at a new way of dealing with our waste, and to just throw it in a landfill is not the solution. After we're letting it rot for 2 weeks at the end of our laneway anyway, what's the point in just throwing it in another landfill, another expanding landfill, another built landfill? That's a complete waste of all this effort. What's the saving in the long run there?
Okay, let's open everyone now. Go ahead.
Can I get the first... go ahead, Rick.
I think Scott's exactly right.
But keep it brief, okay?
Scott's exactly right. You know, I wish I could... You know, I'd love to give you false promises that we're going to return to weekly garbage collection. But that's never going to happen. Council's never going to make that happen. They'll never approve it.
Whoa, and we just lost the election. We can't go against weekly garbage. It's a hot button topic.
Scott's suggestion that we deal with some extra pickups in the summer, if that's possible without extreme extra cost to the city, that's something I think we could look at. But, you know, we have to do something to avoid our need for a new dump. So whether we're concerned about the environment and we see diverting all recyclables as the answer, or whether we see it as an opportunity to move us to energy from waste or incineration,
here.
The solution is the same. We need to divert our recyclables and bring ourselves to a position where the provincial government will consider granting us a license for energy from waste projects or even incineration. The province has only granted one license in the last 25 years, and that license carried very strict conditions. And those conditions are, you must be diverting all of your recyclables, so green bin, blue bin, black box, before you can use incineration. So if someone wants incineration, or energy from waste, or just using organic separation as the solution, it all has the same prescription. That prescription is we collect the stinky, wet garbage in the green bin every week, and we collect the dry and non-stinky garbage every second week. But the idea that we will someday flip back to what we had in the 70s or what we had 10 years ago or 8 years ago, the idea that we're going to flip back and collect the dry, odorless garbage every week, and the wet, odor-filled garbage in the green bin only every second week. That's just not going to happen. And if it ever did happen, we would give up our opportunity to do some of the things that Scott was mentioning. So I urge everybody to take a long-term view of this. Do you want to dump?
On the garbage issue, I think there's a lot of hypocrisy here because, I've seen what... I think the part of the garbage solution is to make less garbage. And when I go by Councillor Trelli's house and I see, really, let's not... Garbage is an important issue to everyone, but I'm getting tired of hearing about it. And as I told you, I've pledged zero means zero means zero. And one part of the zero is I'm not going to impose my views on anything else. So should we have weekly garbage in College Ward? Personally, I don't think so. I'm a big supporter of the Green Bin program. But if that's what people want in College Ward, what do the people at College Ward want? Do you want weekly garbage, knowing that it's going to lead to environmental disaster? I think we need to make the program better. And I don't think we need a lecture from Councillor Trelli on garbage. Because especially after he won't even read the contract, it's just hypocrisy for him to pose as a.
If I may interject, Craig, and thank you for those comments. Probably the single most important issue to the residents in College Ward
is garbage.
Is garbage.
No,
restoring
it's
their weekly.
It's honesty.
Let me finish.
Okay.
That is probably the biggest issue that I'm hearing at the door. By the time we get the green bin bill, it'll probably be close to $300 million. That is unfortunate crime. Because we should have a road to incineration. I fully agree with Scott on this.
We need
a 10-year plan. In
we
Halton,
need to change.
Craig, please.
Okay, sorry.
In 10 years, Halton, it took 10 years for Halton to build an incinerator. It cost $250 million to build that incinerator. And it's going to cost us almost $300 million for the green bin when the total bill is in. We got so off the rails in 2003 because everything had to be green and everything had to be diverted. And to Mr. Shirelli's comment, to get to that 60% diversion rate did not require a source organics program. It required black and blue box recycling. But now we've ridden the horse of Glasgow, which we've given three extensions to, and because of the stream of the Plasco system, we are not going to be able to turn Plasco into our road to incineration.
Can I ask you a question, please?
Yes, go ahead, Craig.
Okay. Do you use your green bin?
Absolutely, I do.
Councillor Trelli, why don't you use
If not, I'd have maggots in my garbage every week.
Well, go vegetarian, then you won't have maggots.
Well, that's why we lost our weekly garbage, Craig.
Maggots?
The only reason we lost our weekly garbage was to bring the green bin numbers up on a contract that this councillor didn't read. They couldn't pick up a calculator, and Rick actually participated in one of the trials.
I know that.
Jan Harder said, if you think we're going to hit 80,000 tons, you're in la-la land, and then she voted for the contract.
Okay.
God bless Gord Hunter.
Right. Let's stop there. Thank you very much. We'll go back to Scott McLaren's. You've got 30 seconds on your own to wrap up on this topic. Go ahead. All I can say on this topic is that in my time going door to door, this is a big issue. People want, at least in the summer when we have that rot, the weekly garbage pickup. It needs to be done, but that's short term. And we also need to look, as I was insinuating earlier, at incineration to deal with this long term. To get rid of the dumps, to get rid of this long-term waste, and perhaps sell that energy back on the grid and help out the city itself.
All right, we'll stop there, and we'll move on to another topic. Now I'll direct this question to Rick Shirelli. I want to talk about crime and safety, because as Ottawa has grown as a city, I think this has become an increasing concern to many residents that we're starting to have some big city problems. We've seen an increase in the number of shootings this year, for example, over last year. And I know Ottawa is still, by comparison, a very safe city. But is there a concern about this? And what are we doing about it? What should the city do about protecting its residents?
Okay, well, certainly it's a concern. And I think the solutions often are things that people don't take seriously enough. We've heard the police chief on several occasions say, tell everyone policing is not just the job of the police, it's also the job of the community. And 10 years ago, the Morrison Gardens area was one of the highest crime rate areas in the entire city. And we moved in there with a number of positive programs and with the assistance of Crime Prevention Ottawa. and we established their first neighborhood watch. And we had a community, again, that was crime-laden, community members stepping forward, participating in neighborhood watch in partnership with the police. We had the police bring in new measures, including youth on the move, to assist in the fight against crime there. Today, Morrison Gardens' crime rate is over 75% lower than it was then, and it's one of the lower for that type of community in the entire city.
Well, I've been to Morrison Gardens too, and I don't think you're going to get a single vote in there, so...
Go ahead, it's open to everyone now.
Well, on the issue of crime, I think we need less of it. I'm against crime. Scott, do you want to...
I agree with you completely on that point.
You're against crime too?
Yes, I am.
I know Rick's against crime, but so why does he conduct... I'm not saying he conducts criminal activity. I'm not saying that he deserves to be jailed, but come on, if we're talking crime... Crime is important, but I think the root causes of crime, if you want to look at the root causes of crime, I think it's criminals who are the root causes of crime. And they're looking at our politicians, and they're saying, wow, they're on the scam, why can't we? You know, I think we've got to look beyond the facile solutions. We've got to address the issue of gang crime. The residents of Bell's Corners, and I'm sure every other part of College Ward, are terrorized by these thugs or... go out at 3 o'clock in the morning and go through your car, go through your garage. My neighbor lost 2 bikes the other day. We have to deal with crime by setting the example as politicians. You know, if there's crime at the top, there's going to be crime at the bottom. I think we need some more opportunities for youth rather than... We need jobs, basically.
Seriously, folks, crime is a serious matter. In College Ward, we don't have the experience that Bay Ward, Gloucester South, and Vanier have. There are specifically 3 areas, and this is a citywide issue. This is not a ward issue, but I bring those 3 wards to bear because they have particular problems with crime in those areas. One of the planks in my platform is to give Ottawa Housing some teeth. And to have an audit of the 22,400 social housing units that we manage in this city, because a lot of your crime comes out of those social housing units. For whatever reason, I do applaud Rick Shirelli and the Ottawa Police Chief Bordelot with regards to their initiatives on mentoring children, and the Ottawa Boys and Girls Club and getting kids off the street is the best way of doing that. But the problem is drugs. The problem is people that are socially disadvantaged are making money using Ottawa Housing as their front to sell these drugs. We can't throw people out of a social housing complex that easily. We can't audit as well as we should, but yet we have program managers and $100,000 a year salaried people that basically are stakeholders in this, and we need Ottawa Housing to be given more teeth by the city and by the police department to clean the problem up.
I agree with you, Guy, about the...
Thanks, Craig.
Well, not on everything, though. Okay. But I agree with you that... I agree with you that the drugs business and the gangs business... I don't think you should be picking on people who live in... It sounds like you're picking on those poor people. But anyway, I think another angle to this is youth need more sports opportunities. Really, something to do, someplace to hang out. And a small micro example is in Bell's Corners, where the outdoor rinks were beautiful. All the kids would show up there free. And we need sports activities. Everything's been shut down in Bell's Corners. The outdoor rinks in Lewin Park have been taken over by... Rick's pseudo community association. So I think we need to use our existing resources, give kids some physical education opportunities. It's not the answer for everyone, but it's a lot better than spouting truisms. Bullshit, I think I was meant to say.
Again, to Councillor Shirelli's credit, I live right by Morrison Gardens, and there has been a marked improvement in the reduction of crime in those areas.
A lot of crime goes unreported, though.
Absolutely, Craig, but the key thing is, it's the crime you hear about. It's the crime, the stabbings, and the guns, and the gangs, and the markets, and the shootings at 2 o'clock in the morning. We spend $528 million on our police budget. Why can't we put some cameras in these troubled areas to basically use the same strategy that London, England has used in their social housing? Why can't we use some best practices that other municipalities like New York are using in their public housing by putting cops on bikes and having more foot patrols? The bottom line is, we know when it happens.
Well,
it's Friday and Saturday night.
Bikes.
It's Friday and Saturday night. And what happens, as soon as the call comes in, there's 12 police cars that come raging up the street on Ritchie or Poulet and Bay Ward. There's a big problem. Why can't we put more boots on the ground
if we know
the times that this crime is happening? And again, targeting these gangs in the cars, and the parking lots in the city are being used as drug drop zones.
Yep.
Do you know how many times I've seen the swanked out bling car sitting in a McDonald's parking lot waiting for another person to jump in and jump out? We need our police at the front lines of these places, and we need to give them more powers to be able to search and seize these cars when there's reasonable grounds to be able to do so.
We'll stop there. We'll go back to Rick Shirelli for 30 seconds.
Okay, well, I think experience really matters here, and it really produces results, because when Morrison Gardens used to be an awful lot like Bay Ward. In fact, it used to have a higher crime rate than Bay Ward. And we went in there with positive solutions. We turned it around. I know firsthand some of the problems that we have to deal with. We've worked hand in glove with the community police officer. We've set up seminars for seniors to avoid being victims of scams. And we've done an awful lot to fix this problem. And we'll continue to do so.
Thank you. And we have time for one more question, but we won't have any debate, so I'm just going to ask a question and each of you will get a chance to respond to it. You'll have 30 seconds, and then we'll move to the closing statement. So the question is, and I'll start with Craig McCauley, do you support the plan for phase two of light rail, and do you think the money will be there from other levels of government to pay for it? You've got 30 seconds. Go ahead.
Only 30 seconds to talk about light rail? Well, okay, in 30 seconds, I'll say I don't really support it, but I don't see at this point we have any choice. I'm certainly not going to push the reset button on that. So we're going to, you know, I'm like other people, we can't go back on that. But it is a terribly flawed plan, and I think it's time to make some changes. I support it because it's too late now, but it's not going to help College Ward at all, really.
Thank you. Guy Annable, you're next. You've got 30 seconds. Go ahead.
I agree with Craig on this one point, that we can't go back on light rail phase two. But the key problem is...
One at a time, please.
The key problem is we have a light rail system in stage one that ends at Tunney's Pasture. So anybody from College Ward or Kanata will take an express bus, which takes approximately 15 minutes to get to Tunney's Pasture, through one of the award-winning transit ways that Andy Hayden set up.
Yeah.
And we'll stop at Tunney's Pasture to transfer to a train for a 90-second downtown trip to get to their office.
Okay.
That was bad planning.
All right.
Three
Scott McLaren's Craig McCauley, you've had your turn on this, so please allow the other candidates to speak now. You've got 30 seconds, Scott.
I think the one thing we're forgetting to mention here is that is if you are getting that express bus, the bus services in College Ward are bad overall, but I think... Now that it is too late to get back on this plan, we can look at this as a good thing. There will be buses off the road, which we can, I guess, appropriate for our use. We have a college there. Students need to get to and from school. I myself spent 6 years getting to Carleton down the 118. It's miserable. I think we can relocate those resources.
Okay. We'll stop there. Thank you. Rick Shirelli.
Of course, I support phase two of light rail, and I do believe we're going to get support from the senior levels of government. We already have one of them committed. I'm really proud of the first steps we're taking. When Toronto was our size, that's when they started their subway system. And now we have an opportunity to move to that type of rapid transit as well. We have the new baseline station tunnel, which is created underground. It's massive, and yet most people don't even know it's there. And when the trains get to that, College Ward is going to be the hub and very connected to phase two.
We'll stop there and we'll move to the closing statements. Once again, each candidate will have 1 minute for a closing statement, and we'll do them in the reverse order of the opening statements. So, Guy Annable, you're up first. You've got 60 seconds. Go ahead.
On October 27th, once every 4 years, you have a choice for mayor and council. The last 4 years has been a rocky ride, from losing your garbage to green bin contracts that the incumbent doesn't read, and to say that he was being misled by city staff. If you can't read a contract, you're not doing your job. That was one of the triggers that made me run. Please visit my website, www.guyannable.ca. It's on the bottom of your screen. There is a number of videos on my website, which I painstakingly took a lot of time to edit. One is Ken Hughes' delivery of the July 9th audit to city council members. It is the only recorded archive of Ken delivering the recommendations for the green bin audit. That will go down in the city's history as a very, very black mark. It was a crime, folks. And Light Whale Transit and the abdication of duties for city lands to only report back to city council
after the
lands have
been
purchased.
That's time. Thank you. Next up is Craig McCauley. You've got 1 minute. Go ahead.
Okay, zero means zero means zero. My first promise, I'll accept zero money from the taxpayer. Second promise, I will spend zero money on getting elected. Third promise, I will exercise zero personal power once elected. I have some questions for my opponents. I'm going to put them on my website, especially the questions for Rick. Like, why did you lie about Don Robertson, as Earl McRae and the Sun said? Lots of interesting questions. So go to my website. It's bellscorners.wordpress.com. You get that anyway. So please, it's time for a change. It's time to end corruption. It's time to end bullying. It's time to end lying. It's time for accountability, transparency, and time for a new politician, a new type of politician, the anti-politician like me. Zero means zero means zero. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry, that was so late.
Next, Rick Shirelli. You've got 60 seconds. Go ahead.
Thanks, Mark. We need experience now more than ever at City Hall. This election, an unprecedented number of veteran city councillors are not seeking re-election. And that means we need to rely on the experience we have available to help make council work smoothly. And council has been working smoothly this last 4 years, especially compared to the previous few terms. We have been bang on at delivering taxes at the targeted amount, at or about inflation. We've produced the Lansdowne development, which I played a major role in and was one of the leaders. And we've turned our attention to protecting the character of our neighborhoods, like Bel Air, Center Point, City View, Ryan Farm, and Crestview, by getting measures in place to prevent illegal rooming houses and illegal home conversions.
Okay. So we'll have to stop there. Thank you. Finally, Scott McLaren, go ahead. You've got 1 minute as well.
At this point in time, with so many councillors moving on, we have a chance for a big change. We can bring in change at every level. I think, as we've shown today, there are options for change. We can look at any number of candidates, but I like to think that I've shown a level head, and I guarantee you at least a dedication to hard work. As you know, our incumbent, Rick Shirelli, came in young, with a promise of hard work. I think I too can bring you that hard work, that dedication. And I don't think we need to look at my re-election in 4 years. I think we can turn this into an election by election basis, looking at what's best for the community as each moment passes.
Okay, thank you very much to all the candidates for participating in the debate. And thank you for watching. We'll see you again next time on the local campaign.